Welcome home to Radiant Life Church.
It's great to have you join us for church online from our home.
Now, I can't speak for everyone else, but for me, it feels like this season has lasted a lot longer than I expected. And that's made a real impact on some of our plans and our expectations. Probably one of the groups that's been impacted the most are our graduating high school seniors.
You're right.
Thank you. I've been waiting 20 years to hear you say that. You know, I remember when I graduated high school, how much we looked forward to that graduation ceremony. And many of our seniors don't get that ceremony, or at least not anytime soon. And so as a church family, I think it's really important that we honor one of the largest groups of graduating high school seniors that we've had in a very long time. Congratulations to our homeschool student, Hunter. Congratulations to Lincoln High School senior Keontae. Congratulations to Lodi High School seniors Chelsea, Justine, Liam, and Miriam. And congratulations to Vista Oaks Charter School senior Matt. I am so proud of these students. They've worked so hard for this, and they really make Radiant Life Church great.
They do. They are amazing, amazing students. And I want you to know that if you drive by our church campus, you will see signs that are congratulating them. So when you're out and about, and speaking of drive-by, we are planning a special drive-by graduation parade on May 23rd. And we'd love to have you join us. You can meet us at the church parking lot on May 23rd at 10:30, and we are going to drive by each of their homes and just congratulate them, shout out to them, and just let them know how proud we are for each one of them and all of that they have accomplished.
You know, that's a great opportunity for everyone in our church family, whether we have a direct relationship with these students or not. They are part of our church family, and this is an opportunity for us to get out of our homes, stay in our cars, and just let them know that we love them and we believe in them as they carry on the legacy that Jesus has given to us and the legacy that this church is sharing with our community. So we look forward to seeing you in the parking lot of Radiant Life Church, where we'll leave at 10:30 a.m. on Saturday, May 23rd, to honor our graduating high school seniors.
Yeah. You know, speaking of legacy, there are some great scriptures and promises that the Lord gives us. And one that has really spoken to me over the years, I believe, is a promise that our high school seniors can cling to during this season. And it's found in Jeremiah 29:11, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." And I believe that that word speaks true for each one of our high school graduates, that God has something amazing in store for each one of you. I know that He has great plans for you. I know this has been a difficult season, but He knew that you could withstand this trial and that on the other side, you are going to come out stronger, and He is going to open up amazing doors for you because you are world changers.
You know, that's a promise that we can all take hold of in difficult and confusing times, because it's a promise that God gave to His people when they were entering into captivity, and they were going to be in captivity for 70 plus years. And this was an opportunity for the Lord to say, "I know the plans I have for you. So just abide in my presence and thrive during this unexpected season of waiting." That's a word for our entire church.
Absolutely. You know, I think it'd be fitting for us to pray for our high school graduates. So if you would join me by bowing your heads with me. Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much for each one of our high school seniors who are graduating, God. I thank you for Hunter and Keontae, for Chelsea, Justine, Liam, Miriam, and Matt. God, I thank you for their relationship with you, God, and their desire to honor you with all that they do. Lord, I am so grateful for your word that speaks truth and power and life into our situations. And Father, I just pray a blessing over each one of them today, that you would go before them, Lord God, as they begin to walk into adulthood. Father, I pray that you would go before them, that you would guide their steps and open up doors for them, Lord God, that no man could shut, that you would use them as a light and a beacon in this world, Lord God, to draw many to you. And we just pray your blessing over them and their families today.
Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon our graduating high school seniors and everyone in our church family. Lord, I pray that each one would feel a fresh anointing and equipping that comes as you pour out your gifts upon your people. And Lord, we ask you during this season that our church would be a shining light in this community and around the world through our online service, God, to be able to spread hope and good news while many are living in fear. Father, may we not be taken captive by fear, but may we always be reminded that we are victorious, for this is an opportunity for you to show your healing power, Lord, for those who are sick, God, those who are afraid. And Father, this is an opportunity for you to show your grace and your mercy to those who are far from you, many who have denied you. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that their hearts would be softened and that they would receive you as Lord and Savior. God, may you heal our land, Lord God. May you spread the good news across this nation and around the world through your people boldly stepping up and sharing the joy that we have in Jesus Christ. We pray these things in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, I am really excited, Pastor Anayansi, because there's another graduate. He's not graduating from high school. Mm-hmm. He's graduating from Lee University in Cleveland, Tennessee, where he has been studying for ministry. And his name is Grayson Russell. And Grayson is very, very special to me. He's like part of our family. I got to know Grayson when he was just a young child. He was actually in the cast of one of our Bible Man episodes. And he has been in a number of Hollywood films, but he loves the Lord with all his heart. He's a great youth leader and worship leader. And today we have the privilege of having my good friend, Grayson Russell, lead us in worship. So let's worship together with Grayson Russell.
Well, hello, Radiant Life Church. My name is Grayson Russell, and it is good to be back with you guys again. I'm sorry that I couldn't be with you there again in person. But either way, greetings from Cleveland, Tennessee. I hope this video finds you well. And we're just going to go ahead and get into some worship. We got some stuff that you should know that you should be familiar with. And either way, whether you're sitting on your couch or you're in your bed or you're outside enjoying the weather, whatever that looks like, if you would just go ahead and just enter into worship with us, I'd appreciate it. And I know we all would. I know this is a crazy time to try to really attempt to do anything. I know this has been such a disruption that none of us ever saw coming. But needless to say, the Lord's with her either way. So, I hope you guys enjoy this. Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in, oh, his love for me. Yes, his love. And who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. And I'm a child of God, yes I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me, oh, his grace runs deep. I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. And who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. And I'm a child of God, yes, forsaken. Oh, I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. Oh, I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. Oh, I am who you say I am. Oh, is free indeed. Who I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. And in my Father's house, there's a place for me. Who I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
As we near the 35th anniversary of Radiant Life Church, we have been looking at a series of messages on the theme of passing a legacy from one generation to the next. And today, we turn our attention to the legacy of perspective. Now, business cards have been around for a very long time, and for anyone who doesn't see the value in a business card or understand what they're really all about, historically, they date all the way back to ancient Egypt, where people would paint ceramic tiles with their names and a description of their vocation. A similar approach was used in ancient China. And then in colonial Europe, business cards took a different form. Ladies of stature would paint a fan with their name as a form of introduction or a token gesture that they might give to a friend or an acquaintance. Men would print small cards, and it might have their title on it or their vocation. And then when business cards came to the New World, they were primarily used by men and women who were trying to drum up business and expand their relationships. And they would often use them as what were called calling cards. They would visit someone's home or place of work, and they would leave that card as a reminder, hey, let's get in touch again. Those cards have continued to pass on right into the 21st century, and people still have business cards. In fact, in the 1800s, business cards were used in some pretty creative ways. The Republican Party had a candidate for President of the United States by the name of Abraham Lincoln, and the opposing party, the Democrats, didn't want him to be elected as president, so they printed fake business cards that talked about all the negative things about Abe Lincoln. A guy named Albert Einstein had a very simple business card. I say a guy named Albert Einstein. I think most of us know who he was. Why did he even need a business card? And then there's Bill Gates, a young software engineer whose business card was really flashy and had a lot of color. But let's use the example of my business card for just a moment. It's just black and white. And if I asked you to describe my business card, you might say that it has black print on a white background. No? Oh, you might say that it has a white background with black print on it. You wouldn't? Oh, that's because you're looking at this side, which has a black background and white print, but I'm looking at the reverse, where the colors are opposite. You see, I'm not saying that you were wrong, but that doesn't mean that I was wrong. We just have different perspectives. And many times, the way we see God, ourselves, and others is impacted by our perspective. So today I want to look at the legacy of perspective that was passed from Jesus to a man named Saul of Tarsus. And we find this in Acts chapter 9, where we will begin to read at verse 1. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, so that if he found any there who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," he replied. Would you bow your head with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truth of your word that speaks to our hearts and lives today. God, we thank you for the example of the legacy of perspective that Jesus, our resurrected Savior passed to Saul of Tarsus so that we one day might receive and pass it on to our children, our grandchildren, and the emerging generation. Father, may we embrace your perspective, I pray, in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the legacy of perspective is evident in our attitude, altitude, and aptitude. Merriam-Webster's online dictionary offers this definition for attitude, a feeling or a way of thinking that affects a person's behavior. So let's look at Saul's attitude when he witnessed the execution of one of the first Christian martyrs, a man named Stephen. We read in Acts chapter 7, beginning at verse 57. At this, they covered their ears and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed at him, dragged him out of the city, and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he fell asleep, and Saul approved of their killing him. Stephen prayed for Saul and the men who stoned him to death, but their attitudes prevented them from recognizing the truth of Jesus, for which Stephen was willing to give his life. We see Saul's attitude escalate in Acts chapter 8, verse 3. But Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off both men and women and put them in prison. Stephen's prayer didn't seem to have any effect on Saul's attitude. In fact, his attitude was so bad that he persecuted the Christians even worse. He wanted to see more death, more carnage. And he did. That's because Saul had a very high self-image, too high. See, altitude is the height of an object above a surface. Saul was so zealous that he actually went out seeking the opportunity to persecute first century Christians. He sought them out. Saul was a man on a mission, and he looked down on those who followed the way. Now, that's the name that was given to the first followers of Jesus, because Jesus declared, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. So before we were called little Christs or Christians, we were called the people of the way. That's our legacy. But look at how his altitude changed when he encountered the highest authority of all. In Acts chapter 9, verse 4, we read, he fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Our altitude literally changes when we encounter the highest authority of all, Jesus Christ. Saul literally fell to his knees before the resurrected Jesus. He had put himself on a pedestal, but the sight of Jesus humbled him and put him into a submissive posture. If we will humble ourselves and take a submissive posture, then and only then can we begin to embrace the legacy of perspective that allows us to see God, ourselves, and this world in a manner where transformation is the only option. In Acts chapter 9, verse 6, we read that Jesus said, now get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do. This is an interesting statement that could only come to one who is down on his knees. Not just the fact that Jesus said, get up and go, but the fact that Jesus said, you will be told what you must do. Jesus was not approaching Saul of Tarsus as an equal. He did not say, get up and go into the city, and we will negotiate the terms by which you'll serve me. No. He said, get up and go into the city, and you will be given orders. You will be told what you must do. Aptitude is simply our capacity for learning coupled with an inclination toward doing. Saul already had an inclination toward doing, but he also had the capacity to learn. He was a very intelligent man. It's just that his attitude and altitude prevented him from embracing the legacy of perspective that God had for him until the moment when he humbled himself and got up and went into the city and waited to be told. In order for Saul to be used by God, he would have to submit and surrender to God's will. So the Lord spoke to a man named Ananias, who didn't want to have anything to do with the murderous Saul of Tarsus. We read in Acts chapter 9, beginning at verse 15. But the Lord said to Ananias, go, this man is my chosen instrument to proclaim my name to the Gentiles and their kings and to the people of Israel. I will show him how much he must suffer for my name. Friend, I have to tell you that when I read that passage, I am moved to emotion because God loved a man who killed his first followers. When I read this passage, I read that God had been preparing Saul to accomplish a very specific mission, and that mission was going to involve suffering. But Saul would have to be blinded by the glory of God before his plan could be revealed. God had a plan for Saul, and God knew that Saul had the aptitude to become the most prolific evangelist in church history. God has a plan for you, and God is able to give you the aptitude through the Holy Spirit if you will simply embrace his will for your life and receive the legacy of perspective. In Acts chapter 9, verse 22, we read, yet Saul grew more and more powerful and baffled the Jews living in Damascus by proving that Jesus is the Messiah. Acts 13 is the last place in the New Testament where Saul of Tarsus is called by the name Saul, which means desired. At that point, he began to be called Paul, which means small or little. You see, he was once the big man on campus, but now he embraced the legacy of perspective that Jesus passed on to him. Paul recognized the significance of Jesus and discovered that his own value was not in himself, but in Christ. The Holy Spirit would inspire Paul to pen much of what we now hold as the New Testament of the Bible. Friend, I want to encourage you today with powerful words that the Holy Spirit gives to us through Paul when he wrote to one of the first century church leaders named Timothy. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, beginning at verse 15, we read, here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for this very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Friend, the legacy of perspective is all about attitude, altitude, and aptitude. We must ask ourselves, do I have an attitude that allows me to see God, myself, and others through his perspective? Have I lifted myself up and taken an altitude that distorts my view of God? Do I see him as an equal, or do I see him as the superior? Do I see others as insignificant or less than myself? Or do I see them as so valuable to Almighty God that he would send his one and only Son to pay the price for their sin, just as he did for mine? And do I have the aptitude to stretch and to grow and to try new ways of communicating the good news of Jesus to my friends, my family, and even to those I've never met who desperately need the Savior? You see, if you haven't embraced the legacy of perspective, perhaps it's because you haven't embraced Jesus. I want to encourage you today that choosing to follow Jesus is as easy as A, B, C. The letter A stands for admit that you've sinned and ask God to forgive your sin. The letter B stands for believe that Jesus paid the price for your sin when he died on the cross. And the letter C stands for choose. And that's exactly what I want to give you the opportunity to do right now, to choose for yourself to follow Jesus. If you'd like to take this first step in the right direction, then I want to invite you to bow your head and repeat this simple prayer after me. You can make it your own if you mean it. Dear Jesus, I know that you are good, and I want you to be the Lord of my life. So I admit that I have sinned, and I ask you to forgive my sin, because I believe that you paid the price for my sin when you died on the cross. And that's why I choose to follow you today and tomorrow and each day throughout my life's journey. Thank you, Jesus, for coming into my life, for taking away my sin, and for making me a new creation. Thank you, Jesus, for claiming victory over death in the grave when you rose to life, so that I might live with you for all eternity. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you just prayed that prayer with me for the very first time, then I want to invite you to send me an email at prayer@rlclodi.com. You see, prayer changes our attitude, our altitude, and our aptitude, and invites us to accept the legacy of perspective. So if you send an email to prayer@rlclodi.com and let me know that you prayed that prayer with me just now, then I'd like to send you some free resources to help you as you step forward on this journey of faith. Here at Radiant Life Church, we like to say that our mission is to share life's journey through growing relationship with Jesus Christ, because everyone counts. You are important to God. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Come on, let's worship on this one together. You give life.
You give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. Come on, sing. This is your breath. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. And great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Together, it's your breath. 'Cause it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. And great are you, Lord. Come on, and great. And great are you, Lord. Jesus, we thank you for everything that you are and everything that you've done, God, regardless of the situation. Jesus, regardless of this global pandemic, you are still on the throne and you still know everything that's going on. Regardless, God, of our situation, of everything that is going the way we thought that it shouldn't. God, right now I ask for peace and for strength, Jesus, and for comfort in every situation, God, every encounter that we're facing. God, every encounter that we will face, Jesus, and every difficulty we're having, God, with every encounter that we've already faced. Because, Jesus, regardless, you are still up there. and you still know what's going on. And we thank you for it. For who taught the sun where to stand in the morning? And who told the ocean you can only come this far? And who showed the moon where to hide till evening? Whose words alone can catch a falling star? Well, I know my Redeemer lives, and I know my Redeemer, He lives. Let all creation testify, let this life within me cry, I know my Redeemer lives. The very same God that spins things in orbit, oh, He runs to the weary, the worn and the weak. And the same gentle hands that hold me when I'm broken, they conquer death to bring me victory. And I know my Redeemer lives, and I know my Redeemer, He lives. So let all creation testify, let this life within me cry, I know my Redeemer, He lives. Shame, and oh, He lives forever. I'll proclaim that the payment for my sins was the precious life Jesus gave. But now He's alive, and there's an empty grave. 'Cause I know my Redeemer lives, and I know my Redeemer, He lives. So let all creation testify, let this life within me cry, I know my Redeemer lives. And oh, He lives to take away my shame. And oh, He lives forever. I'll proclaim that the payment for my sins was the precious life Jesus gave. But now He's alive, and there's an empty grave. 'Cause I know my Redeemer lives, and I know my Redeemer, He lives. Let all creation testify, let this life within me cry, I know my Redeemer lives.